to analyze antibodies in people's blood. And basically, the way that we set this up was that we took bits of all viral proteins, of all the viruses that affect or infect human beings, and used it to detect antibodies to viral antibodies that to viruses that you've previously been infected with. So the way this works is that we can use recombinant DNA to fuse little bits of all the viral proteins to a bacterial virus, so that when it makes a new virus particle, which is really like a little spaceship, it decorates the outside of it with pieces of that virus. But inside the virus, the bacterial virus, there's DNA that we can analyze. So we can take just a drop of blood, and there are enough antibodies in that to fish out amongst this library of hundreds and hundreds of thousands of different pieces of viruses, the very very bacteriophage that are being bound, or the bacteriophage that express fragments of this of the viral protein. So you can use that to fish them out. You can sequence them, and then that can tell you all the viruses that you've been infected with in your life.
So basically, in a single drop of blood, I can see everything I've ever had. That's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, and it's very,
Go ahead.
very revealing, I must say.
How about your work with measles? What are you guys doing with measles right now, and what's that showing you?
Well, of course, measles is a virus that's been a pathogen for humans for, probably centuries and centuries, and it's one of the most infectious viruses on the planet. There's a number that they associate with viruses called an R0 factor, and basically what that means is that number means the number of people, person who gets that virus, actually infect. So there's a the R0 for measles is 15. So one person on average infects 15 people. So we're very interested in detecting the measles virus antibodies with Vir scan, but we had a hard time detecting it because most of the time until recently, the only antibodies that people make are when they get vaccinated, or if you're of a certain age, over 60, before they introduce the vaccine, those are people who got infected with measles. So we were very interested in trying to understand why we were having a little bit of trouble detecting it. So it turns out that now that measles is starting to come around again because people aren't getting vaccinated, there are people available who've been recently infected. So we were interested in getting those. We got samples of children before and after measles from the Dutch. They had a Bible Belt there where there were very low vaccination rates. And so our collaborator was able to get permission to get blood samples from all those children before the epidemic of measles hit and then afterwards. And so we were able to analyze that, and we could detect the measles antibodies very clearly in these children. But in adults, the antibody levels are very low because it's been so long since they've been infected and they don't get challenged. So what we found out about measles, which was interesting, was that as I said, we could detect the antibodies to measles, but when we do this assay, we look at all the antibodies in a person. And what we found was that children that are infected with measles, the levels of all the previous antibodies that they use to protect themselves have dropped precipitously. And it turns out the measles is destroying the antibody factories that constitute your immunological memory. So after you're infected with the measles, your previous protection is partially erased, and it can be up to 70% of your former protection can be gone. And this was very interesting because in 2015, in a analysis was done retrospectively effectively on in the UK about when they introduced the measles vaccine. People, every year they took very good records. About 400 kids died of the measles. It said it on the death certificate. But when they introduced the vaccine, those kids didn't die anymore. No one got the measles. But they saw a drop in childhood mortality of over 3,000 cases. So the interpretation is that the children who are getting the measles remain vulnerable to other infections afterwards because they've had their immune memory erased. We call it immune amnesia.
That must mean a lot for getting a vaccine and making sure we're all vaccinated for the measles and then other things out. Is that correct?
Yeah, it really tells you that the measles vaccine is much more valuable. I think measles probably was killing about 1% of the people it infected, but it probably caused another 4 or 5% to die. So it's really a very lethal disease. And the vaccine is that much safer or much more valuable because of that. And we also looked at children who've been vaccinated before and after, and we didn't see the drop in antibodies there. So the vaccine's safe and very protective.
The big thing, obviously, everybody wants to know about, everybody's concerned about, is coronavirus. Can you tell us a little bit about what we know in the scientific community about coronavirus right now? What is it? How it sort of was created? Those kinds of things.
Well, it's an RNA virus. It's related to several viruses that infect humans. They're called coronaviruses as a family, and they have specific names. Some are don't cause much of a problem at all. They're like a cold. Two others in recent memory are MERS and SARS were extremely lethal. They would kill 30% of the people that they infected, but they weren't quite as infectious as this virus. This virus is much more infectious than the flu. The R0 value may be as high as 3.5, whereas the flu is more like 1.4. So, they still don't have the numbers exactly right because it's such a rapidly evolving situation and the information's not all in there, but it's pretty clear that it's very infectious. In Boston,
stop you for just a second. The sure. R0 value is one person's infected and they're going to infect 3.5 more people. Is that accurate?
Something like that, yeah.
Sure.
And
higher than the flu, again.
Yeah, the flu is much less than that, about 1.4. At the level of one person infects another person, so it's a flat curve going forward. And then if the number is greater than one, it slowly goes up or goes up much faster. And it's sort of an exponential situation, kind of like compound interest. And so you can imagine that, one becomes two, two becomes four, or one becomes three becomes nine. 9 becomes 27, and it goes up exponentially like that. So that's why it's so dangerous. And it's much more lethal than the normal flu, which kills about 0.1% of people that it infects, usually people who are older or immunocompromised. And this virus is much more lethal than that. They think it's 10 to 20 times more lethal, and it's more infectious. So it's much worse than the regular flu. And they, some people have compared it to the 1918 Spanish flu, the H1N1 flu, and that killed 100 years ago, killed 50 million people, and the population of the Earth was much less then. We're much more interconnected now. The cities are much more dense, so it's a much more serious situation, probably than even that very lethal flu. Now, where this came from, as I was saying, there's a whole family of different coronaviruses, including those very dangerous ones. And they often are evolving and other animals and end up crossing over and adapting to humans. This happens all the time. It may happen with the flu with chickens and you know, there's a West Nile virus and mosquitoes, and there's a swine flu. There's all kinds of different back and forth, because mammals of all kinds are very similar to humans. You know, throughout evolution, they have a lot of the same genes. They have a lot of the same physiology. So the proteins are related. So, you know, there is this back and forth. They think that the closest version of this was a bat virus. And they've sequenced all these viruses, so they know how close they are. Bat virus is a SARS-related virus. That's the closest version that's known to infect people. It's about 79% identical at the DNA level. And the protein level's more highly conserved. That's very kind of technical, but it basically means that at one time they were the same virus and they grew apart over time in evolution. And so people think it probably was the reservoir was a bat. It may have gone to other animals. It broke out in Wuhan, China, at this market. It's not clear exactly how it came out. It could have been someone who also was at the market, was infected somewhere else, and went to the market and infected people who worked there, and it exploded. You can't really figure that out. But, you know, the close quarters of humans and animals probably facilitated this somehow. But it could have happened anywhere in the world. It happened in China. It could have happened in the U.S. Eventually, these sorts of things happen.
What does it do to the body? What does it do to a healthy person? And what does it do to an immunocompromised person? And older people, it seems to have an impact there.
Well, you know, basically any virus that infects you, it's a race between your immune system and the virus. And if the virus is too lethal, it's bad for the virus because it kills you before it can even transmit. So it doesn't usually... It doesn't work to really kill you that fast, usually, okay? But you have to, you know, for the virus's purpose, it wants you to be providing the virus to a lot of other people, and it'll just keep going. What happens when the virus enters your body is that it has, there are particular proteins on certain cells that it latches onto, and that's how it tricks the cell to get inside the cell and start taking over the cell. It hijacks the cell, turns it into a virus factory, spews out virus into your body. It finds these other cells that have these receptors for the virus on it. The protein that it latches onto is called ACE2. It's on a lot of different tissues in your body. The nasal epithelia, it's in your nose, it's in your lungs. It's also in your digestive tract, the colon, ileum, and jejunum. That's the small intestines, and so it replicates there. It destroys some of that tissue. It's also on muscle cells and the heart. It's not clear. You know, it doesn't react exactly the same to everybody. But I would say that if you're immunocompromised, the race between the virus and the immune system is won by the virus. And if it infects every cell it can infect, you're going to die. That's for sure. Your immune system usually catches up. Unfortunately, older people, their immune systems aren't as good over time. Everything sort of becomes less functional. That's certainly true for the immune system. And I think that puts older people at risk. We don't know why young people are doing much better, but it could be their immune systems are better. But I must say that a lot of the people who now are showing up in the hospital are young people. So they're not immune. And if they think they are, they're in big trouble because this is a nasty virus. You know, sometimes they say, 80% is mild. Mild means you're sick for 2 or 3 weeks. It's not mild. It's like when you get the flu. I don't consider that mild. But relative to what else happens, it may seem mild, but I wouldn't say mild as a description, right? Personally.
Yeah, if I was sick for 2 weeks, that doesn't sound like mild.
Yeah, that's not mild. If I have a little cough for a couple of days or a sore throat and goes away, that's mild. So, but some people are asymptomatic and they think that, you know, they don't know for sure, but they could be spreading it more easily because they don't feel as inhibited to talk to people. They think they're well And but you can't be sure. Everyone should really pretend like they have the virus and they don't want to give it to someone else. That's the way you do your social distancing. You know, you assume that you have something that you might communicate to someone else, infect them, and you stay away from them, just like you would your friends or your spouse or your parents. And, you know, we should be all thinking like that. I think that's the mental state we should be in and be very careful.
We're doing this. We're shutting down. We're practicing social distancing. The government's really taken a strong stand in the last week, 2 weeks, to do this. Is that going to be enough to slow the rate of infection? How many Americans will get infected?
Well, I don't think we can know. The epidemiologists have various models. It depends on how many people we have now. I mean, it's really I really have a hard time believing that we're this bad at analyzing and detecting this virus. And, you know, we really basically lost 2 months. And I really don't know how the CDC, I know their budget was cut. I don't know if that's involved, you know, in the last few years, if that had any impact. But it was really a disaster in the rollout. I mean, I expected the government to do a much better job protecting us. And for a while, and I don't understand why, but they were pretending like this wasn't a big deal. But we knew it was a big deal in China. You know, so we're the same. I mean, it's people are people for this virus. So we lost a lot of valuable time. We now are getting the kits out. And that's what's really important is we have to figure out how many infections we have, because we have tens of thousands, undoubtedly. I mean, we're well over, I mean, we're going up to 20,000. I'm sure we're going to have 50 to 100,000 people, you know, and we don't know how many asymptomatic people are. The only people that are getting tested right now are people who have symptoms who go to you know, get tested. And, you know, one of the things about the virus test that they have, that the one that was didn't work at first, but now they fixed it, is that that detects the DNA of the virus, the RNA of the virus. It's an RNA virus. But that detects the nucleic acid RNA of the virus if you have it. But if you've already had it and you got rid of it, they can't tell because the virus is gone. But you would have an antibody response, and we're hoping that we can get our beer scan assays up to test a broad number of people to really get an idea of how many people were infected overall, you know, and how many people might be spreading it. And hopefully we can get that moving rapidly. We're adding the coronavirus to our VirScan platform and hope to be testing more people. But of course, this is my lab. I can't run behave in a hospital or anything. But the key thing about this infection and how bad is it going to be and all that, I think the lessons that we've learned are really from Italy, where you know, it's a very dense population, it's also older, but they did not get a handle on this. And the tipping point is whether you saturate the hospitals. If you get so many cases that you take up all care beds, you know, then you're in big trouble, because there's only so many ventilators in different hospitals. And if the number of really sick people, you know, and they think that 5% of the people who end up with, you know, like 20% they claim are going to end up in the hospital, are going to the hospital. 5% are going to be very serious, and they may need ventilators. And once we run out of ventilators, those people are just going to die. Okay, that's, you can't help them. You know, they need to recover, and they can't breathe properly. So the key is whether we get to that tipping point. And anything that we can do right now to slow down the progression of the virus so it doesn't peak and overwhelm the medical system, anything we can do is going to help. And it may not be perfect, and maybe it'll just completely get us through this. It's not going to get rid of the virus. The virus is here to stay, and it's going to be here for months and years. It'll just be infecting people more slowly. But we're hoping that it doesn't overwhelm our medical system, and it may in certain places and not in others. We don't know. I'm very concerned about New York City. It is highly, highly densely populated. A lot of cases there. We have no idea how many yet, but they're going up very rapidly. It's well over 1,000, and that's just because they started testing like a few days ago. So those sorts of places are going to be very hot spots to watch. But the virus is going to stay here for a long time. And the key is either to find drugs that help people who are infected, but more importantly, to get a good vaccine. There are lots of people working on the vaccines. But as Fauci said, it takes, 1 to 1.5 years to get that really rolled out. There are drugs that people are testing. Unfortunately, the HIV drugs that they tested that block the proteases didn't do anything, but there are multiple other drugs that also block other proteins and related viruses that people are trying. And so all of this stuff's ongoing. People should know pretty soon. And some of those are already FDA approved. Other people are looking for new drugs. So, that may help save some lives of people who are already infected. But long-term, we're looking for a vaccine. And if we get a vaccine, then, that will be able to carry us through to the next stage.
Is there any hope that the summer months will lessen this, that the heat and humidity will do anything to this?
Yeah, that's a good question. We really don't know is the answer. It certainly does for some viruses, and the flu in particular. And people think it's the humidity, but I don't think anyone really knows what it is. But if it's the humidity, I think Florida should be in good shape. anywhere down south. Yeah, I'd hope so. There have been some indications that that I'm interested in seeing how they follow. There's a company that sells electronic thermometers. I think it's Kansi. And they have been tracking, they have an app and they can track what people's temperatures are over a million people spread out the United States. And they have a website that gives a map of what, compared to last year this time, are they seeing more people with temperatures or not? I think that Florida seemed to have a higher than expected average of temperatures, higher temperatures. So you might want to look into that. I think that's a very interesting, app that's on the web. Anyone has access to it. It's public. We don't really know if it's going to tamper down. If it does, that's fantastic. It'll give us some breathing room to get those vaccines going. It won't make things go away. And if it does go down for a while, it will come back. So this is a long haul situation. It's a new normal, and we're not going to, be the same after this. And of course, the economic costs are going to be tremendous. Unemployment will go up. It's already doing that. And people who live from paycheck to paycheck, they're going to have a hard time. So we're going to have to figure out how we can, weather the storm and get to the next stage. And it's going to be stage by stage by stage as we, deal with this new reality.
All right.
Dr. Elledge, we have a question in the chat here, and they're asking, do you know how, with this virus, how long you're going to be contagious?
How long you're going to be contagious?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
That was the question? They don't know exactly. They think that the incubation time is somewhere between 2 days and 14 days, and the average is 5 days. And so, I think as long as you have symptoms, you're definitely infectious. I can't say how long that is. I'm not a physician. I'm a scientist. So, I study viruses, but I don't want to give medical advice because I don't know that. But I suspect that within a few days after being infected, maybe 5 or less, you're infectious all the way until your symptoms go away, and probably a little bit after that. That could be a two-week period. But if people are, I don't want to give out incorrect information, but I thought people who had a temperature or something would be quarantined for 2 weeks. And I don't know if that was just to see if they got really sick or if that was a period of time through which they should recover. I don't really know the answer to that exactly.
That's okay. The biggest thing I think I took away from this was we should all be acting like we have it right now and practicing social distancing, just trying to keep our friends and family safe. So, Dr. Elledge, I appreciate this conversation. Appreciate what you're doing, and hopefully we have some good news soon.
I hope so, too, and thank you for inviting me. I really enjoyed it. Thanks.
All right. Thank you guys for watching, and we'll be back next week.
Okay, take care.